Hello everyone, my name is Manbir Kaur and I'm an aerospace engineer. This is my profile. I'm working as an aviation manager with Aircruise Aviation Private Limited. You can visit the company by clicking on www.aircruiseaviation.com. Further to that, you can connect me on social sites also. Here I have given the links, so you can follow me on social media also. So to talk about, so let's start with the brief introduction. So what is air performance actually? So aircraft performance can be defined as the capability of an airplane to operate effectively while serving a specific purpose. Among the elements of performance are takeoff, landing distances, rate of climb, ceiling, speed, payload, and fuel economy. So there are various factors that affect the performance of an aircraft. So we will be looking onto this various factors and how do they affect to the aircraft performances. So here we can see a picture. So in this picture, here are the different factors which usually influence the performance of an aircraft. So these can be the fuel weight, what the amount of fuel capacity an aircraft is carrying. Next to that is the fuselage payload, that the payload which is into the fuselage of the aircraft. The next to that factor we have is structural weight, that is the overall weight of an aircraft. Then it comes is speed as well as the altitude, what speed and at what altitude the aircraft is flying. After that, we have the propulsion, that is the specific fuel consumption as well as the weight of an aircraft. And also here we have the wing lift to drag as well as the coefficient of lift. So how these factors usually affect the aircraft performance? So we will be having a close look to these all the factors. So first of all, we will be talking about the takeoff. So here we can see a picture of maximum performance takeoff. So this picture is basically representing that the takeoff performance of an aircraft. So the initially when the brakes is released of an aircraft, the aircraft turns into the motion. So while on a runway, it comes into the taxiway. So it comes into the motion, and then next is rotation. So when the gear of landing gear of the nose, it comes into the air, so that term that at that position it is at the rotation. And when the aircraft is completely into air, that when it leaves the ground, then that position is known as the lift off. So the distance from the when the brakes are released to the lift off distance, so this is known as the ground acceleration segment. So when the aircraft is finally lift off, and when it reaches to the 50 feet from the ground, then this angle is known as the best angle of the climb, and that region is known as the takeoff and climb segment. So the takeoff and landing performance. The minimum takeoff distance is of primary interest in the operation of any aircraft because it defines the runway requirements. The minimum takeoff distance is obtained by taking off at some minimum safe speed that allows sufficient margin above stall and provides satisfactory control. So to obtain minimum takeoff distance at specific liftoff speed, the forces that act on aircraft must provide the maximum acceleration during the takeoff roll. So here in this picture, we can see the short takeoff as well as the landing performance of an aircraft. So while an aircraft has to perform at the shorter runway, so that is how a short takeoff and landing is done onto a small runway. While the performance of an aircraft, so here in these pictures, we can see two different weather conditions. So these weather conditions are generally So an aircraft performance is also affected by the runway surface also. While sometimes we have different weather conditions, like it is rainy and the weather and the runway is a little bit too wet, not dry enough, or either on the when it is a sunny day, so the temperature of the runway is a little bit high. So there are weather conditions also, which affects the aircraft takeoff. The different weather effects which do affect the takeoff. So first about the air density. So the takeoff and landings are perhaps two of the most labor-intensive tasks which are involved in piloting an airplane. The takeoff performance of an airplane needs to be matched to the runway and the surrounding obstacles prior to the actually taking off. So if we talk about the air density, the first things comes is the air pressure. So here in this picture, we can see the density of the air. So as we go high to the altitude, the density changes. So to near to the ground, the density is high, and as we go high above the altitude, the density becomes low. So this is one of the cause of an increase in density altitude is the decrease in the air density, so which results in the longer ground run and takeoff distance. So as in this picture, we can see the two pictures here we have. The one is for the dense air and the next one is for the less dense air. So if the air density decreases, the engine propeller combination will not produce as much power, and so the takeoff will also increase. So in addition to the power producing performance of the engine propeller decreasing, the aerodynamic performance of the airplane will also decrease as the air density becomes less. So this is how the air density affects the takeoff of the aircraft. So the next effect is the effect of temperature, which generally impact at the altimeter settings. So in this, there are some conditions in which the weather is a little colder, so as compared to its standard temperature. So in such conditions, the altimeter will overstate the altitude. So the higher altitude, so it will be more overstated. So as well as in other conditions, like when the conditions are warmer than the standard temperature, then again the altimeter will understate your altitude. So if the weather condition is colder, then the altitude will be overstate, and if the weather condition are warmer, then the altimeter will understate. So in this picture, we can see the red bar here is representing the actual and reported altitude also. So if the here in the gray bar, this is the actual setting of the altimeter, and if the standard temperature nearby is there is a hot temperature, then it will proceed. Here we can see, and if the standard temperature is usually there is cold temperature, so it will usually overstate the altitude. So as warmer air has lower pressure, whereas cooler air has higher pressure, so this can seem a little backward since hot air expands and can seem to increase in pressure as it relates to the surface around it. So another impact on takeoff and landing is the effect of the wing. So the effect of proper takeoff speed is especially important when runway lengths and takeoff distance are critical. So in this graph, we can see a tailwind as well as a headwind. So here we can see the ratio of the wind velocity to the takeoff or landing speed, which is shown on the x-axis. And if we talk about the y-axis, here we have the percentage decrease or percentage increase in the landing takeoff or landing distance. So any attempt to the takeoff below the recommended speed means that the aircraft could stall and be difficult to control, or have a very low initial rate of climb. In some cases, an excessive angle of attack may not allow the aircraft to climb out the ground effect. On the other hand, an excessive speed, airspeed at takeoff may improve the initial rate of climb and feel of the aircraft, but produces an undesirable increase in takeoff distance. Assuming that the acceleration is essentially unaffected, the takeoff distance varies with the square of the takeoff velocity. So due to the different conditions, the percentage of increased of takeoff and landing may differ. As we can clearly see into this picture, that in the graph which is plotted over here. So the next factor which comes into the aircraft performance is rate of climb. So what is rate of climb? Rate of climb is a comparison of altitude gained relative to the time needed to reach out that altitude. Rate of climb is simply the vertical component of the aircraft's flight path velocity vector. For maximum rate of climb, a pilot flies the aircraft at VY so as to achieve a maximum gain in altitude over a given period of time. So here in this picture, we can see a graph of altitude to distance. So here we can see two maximum rate of climb angles over here. So this is a graph which is power to the speed. So in this, we can see the different speed. That is first one, we can see the minimum speed graph. Then this, which is represented on a curve, which is in orange in color. So here first we have the point that is for the minimum speed. Then next, here we have for the low cruise speed. And next to that, here we have high cruise speed. And just next to that, in the red curve, we can see that this is the point where the maximum power is available. So up to this point, aircraft can generate the maximum available power. So usually there are three types of climb. So here we can see a graph between the altitude as well as the distance. So this is representing the types of climb. So the first, we can see a normal climb. Then next to that, at VX, we have the maximum angle climb, that is the maximum gradient. So this is usually done to obstruction clearance point speed, to clear any obstruction. Then next we have the best vertical speed, that is the VY, which is mentioned as the maximum rate climb. So what are the factors which usually affect the climb performance of an aircraft? So that is the climb angle and the rate of climb. So there are various factors which usually affects. So the first one is the speed as well as the acceleration of the aircraft. The second one is the mass of the aircraft, like how much payload the aircraft is carrying. The next is the temperature as well as the air density. The by temperature, we mean as compared to the standard temperature, what are the variations. And if I talk about the air density, like what is the density of the air at that time. So next factor we have is wind. So by wind, we mean that the flow of the wind, what kind of wind flow is there, like it is smooth or turbulent. So next factor comes is the retraction of flap and landing gear. So this is the another important factor. So while an aircraft has to take off, so the flaps are extended completely and the landing gears also has to come back to its position after takeoff. So how maximum force does it takes and how fast it is done, so that usually affects that rate of climb. So at last, we have the cabin pressurization. So cabin pressurization somehow also affects the rate of climb. So the next aircraft performance factor is ceiling. So with respect to the aircraft performance, a ceiling is the maximum density altitude of an aircraft that can reach under a set of conditions, which are usually determined by its flight envelope. So the based on maximum climb rates, so ceiling is generally are of different types. So the first type is the absolute ceiling. It means when it reaches to the 0 feet per minute with respect to the rate of climb. So next is the service ceiling. Service ceiling is basically when an aircraft attains the height of 100 feet per minute, that is according to its rate of climb. Then next comes the third is the cruise ceiling. This is when the aircraft reaches the height of 300 feet per minute. And at last we have the combat ceiling, which means when the aircraft attains the height of 500 feet within a minute per minute. So usually there are different kind of performance speed. So first one we will be talking about is indicated airspeed. So the indicated airspeed is the speed which is indicated by the airspeed indicator. So this is the instrument which is used to determine the speed of an aircraft. So in this picture, we can see the airspeed indicator. The speed of the aircraft is usually measured in the knots, which is represented over here. And the needle over here shows the speed of the aircraft. So this is how an indicated airspeed can be checked. So if we talk about the airspeed is basically the difference between the ground speed and the wind speed. So here in this small video, we can see the aircraft at two different speeds. So in the first video, we can see the airspeed is 160 and the ground speed is 200. We can see the wind speed is plus 40. So in the next picture, we can see the airspeed is 240 and the ground speed is 200. So in such case, the wind speed calculated is minus 40. After indicated airspeed, the next speed performance comes is calibrated airspeed. So the calibrated airspeed, which is also shortly named as CAS, it is obtained from the difference between the total pressure and the static pressure. So this difference between the total and static pressure is called the dynamic pressure. So usually there are static probes which are situated into the cockpit region, that is the nose area of an aircraft. So here in the static probes, usually they are the symmetric on the other sides in order to avoid the slip side errors, as well as there are pitots which are situated on the nose area of an aircraft. So the difference between the total pressure and static pressure is determined, and this difference is termed as the calibrated airspeed. So the third comes here is true airspeed. So an aircraft in flight moves in an air mass which is itself in motion compared to the earth. So the true airspeed represents the aircraft speed in a moving reference systems linked to the air mass, or simply the aircraft speed in airflow. So next to that we have the ground speed. So the ground speed represents the aircraft speed in a fixed ground reference system. It is equal to the true airspeed corrected for the wing component. So in this picture, we can see a visual. So in this, we can see a ground speed, true airspeed, as well as a different drift angle. So the angle which is made between the ground speed and true airspeed, so that angle formed is known as the drift angle. So now at last we have the Mach number. So Mach number is a major term which is being used into the aircraft speed. So Mach number is basically the ratio of the speed of any object with respect to the speed of the sound. So by having the ratio of speed of a particular object with respect to the speed of sound, we can determine the Mach number of that object. So usually Mach number is divided into various, while depending upon the unit of the Mach. So if the value of the Mach is less than 1, then that particular speed is termed as subsonic. If the Mach number value is equal to 1, then at that point the speed is known as the transonic. If the value for the Mach number increases than 1.0, then that speed is termed as the supersonic. And if the value for the Mach number increases from 5, so at that point the speed is termed as the hypersonic speed. So talking about the next aircraft performance, so the payload is another factor which usually affects the performance of an aircraft. So usually there are different kind of payloads which an aircraft carry. So these kind of payloads can be termed as the taxi fuel, that is fuel which is being used for taxi. Other than that, the fuel which is used in the fuel reservoirs. After that, we have the total traffic load, that is for the zero fuel weight. Then next, there is also some weight of catering as well as newspapers. So these are the dry operating weights. So next to that, there we have the cabin equipment crews. So this comes under the operational empty weight. So next to that, here we have the propulsion weight of an aircraft. Then there are also the various systems which are installed into aircraft, and as well as the structure of an aircraft. So how can we define these different kind of weights? So if we talk about manufacturer's empty weight, so this is termed as the weight of the structure, power plant, furnishings, systems, and other equipments that are considered an integral part of the aircraft. So this is basically the manufacturer's empty weight, which includes of the structure, power plant, and furnishings. Then next, at second, we have operational empty weight. The manufacturer's weight empty plus the operator's items, that is the flight and cabin crew and their baggage, unusual fuel, engine oil, emergency equipment, toilet chemicals and fluids, galley structure, catering equipment, seats, documents, etc. So all these kinds comes under the operational empty weight of an aircraft. Third we have is dry operating weight. So the total weight of an aircraft which is ready for a specific type of operation, excluding all usable fuel and traffic load. So operational empty weight plus items specific to the type of flight, that is the catering, newspaper, pantry, equipment, etc. Fourth one here is this zero fuel weight. So the weight obtained by addition of the total traffic load, that is payload which includes cargo loads, passengers and passengers bag, and the dry operating weight. So all these weights comes under the zero fuel weight. Next we have is landing weight. So the weight at landing at the destination airport, it is equal to the zero fuel weight plus the fuel reserves. So at the time of the landing, the aircraft should only have the aircraft landing weight must be equal to the zero fuel weight as well as the fuel which is reserved. Then at last we have the takeoff weight. So the weight at takeoff at the departure airport, it is equal to the landing weight at the destination plus the trip fuel, which is the fuel needed for the trip, or to the zero fuel weight plus the takeoff fuel, which is the fuel needed at the brake release point, includes reserves. So this is how the various aircraft weights can be defined. So in this visual, we can see how and where these kind of weights are applied. So first, we will talk about the fuel. So generally, the fuel is majorly stored in the wings of an aircraft. So WFO here represents the weight of the fuel. Then next, we have the engines. So basically, engines are also having some amount of operational weight, which are added into the propulsions also. Then next to that, we have the wings body, which is usually the structural, comes under the structural weight of an aircraft. So each component of an aircraft has some weight. So where MI is the component mass, and G, which is the gravitational acceleration that is acting upon it. So the total aircraft weight can be summed, and there can be summed up as their component weights. So if we have to determine the overall aircraft, we have to sum up the components of the weight. So that is how the total weight of an aircraft can be considered. So if we talk about weight, in order to climb, lift needs to exceed the weight, and to remain level flight, lift will need to be equal to the weight. So essentially, the heavier the plane is, the more the lift will need to produce, resulting in a great angle of attack, increased speed, or a combination of both. A maximum weight is specified for each aircraft as determined by the manufacturer. In any case, in any increase in weight exceeding, this will severely diminish aircraft performance, resulting in unsafe aircraft characteristics. So this says is, so in order to attain a lift at where for a heavy aircraft, the lift has to be greater than the weight of an aircraft. And when the aircraft is in straight and level flight, then lift should be equal to the weight. So there are several performance characteristics which are caused by heavier airplane. So which can be included as, first one is a higher stall speed. So usually, when an aircraft which is in heavy, so the at higher speeds, the aircraft usually gets stalled. So these are usually happens to the heavier airplane. So next is, for a heavier aircraft, there is a higher takeoff speed as well as a longer takeoff run. Third one is poorer climb performance. As the aircraft is usually heavy, then there is somehow the poorer climb performance, that is the poorer climb angle as well as the poorer climb rate. The next we have is a lower cruising level. Due to an aircraft having a lot of payload and it is really very heavy, so there will be a lower cruising level. So next is less maneuverability. So it is all quite often happen, like when an aircraft which is really heavy, it is quite difficult to maneuver an aircraft. So yes, it is very difficult. And so there is less maneuverability when an aircraft is heavy. Next we have is higher fuel consumption and less range and endurance. So if I talk about a cargo airplane or a passenger aircraft, so in these aircraft, these are usually very big and are really heavy. So such aircraft generally need a heavy amount of fuel consumption, and which usually gives less range and endurance, but really require a high fuel consumption. So next, there is reduced cruise speed for a given power setting. So this is another thing that the cruise speed is really reduced. The next is a higher landing speed and a longer landing distance. So this usually happens with heavier aircraft. To land such a heavy plane, the landing distance is required or really long. So last point here is the greater braking requirements when stopping. So it is usually common to have a very heavy braking system for a heavy aircraft. So yes, the heavy airplane usually require a greater braking system to stop it. So this was all about my today's presentation. Here you can see my bio. You can connect me on social media through the links. So this is the book that is the Pilot's Career Guide, which is written by Captain Shekhar Gupta. This book is available on Amazon. You can buy it online from the Amazon. So that was all about my today's presentation. I hope you would like it. Thank you so much for listening to me.